Anyway, well, I hate spittling with that. For those who don't know me, I retired from the Colorado Division of Wildlife after a long career, but I've spent about 32 years working with the Crawford population. And for those who do know me, no heckling, please. And that comment's directed to Paul Jones, if he's still here. Okay, with the Gunnison Basin having the largest population of Gunnison sage-grouse, they get the most press. So I thought it'd be important to talk about one of the smaller satellite populations, the Crawford population, and how we brought it back from the brink of extirpation. I know I wouldn't say that right. While a lot of the settlers and explorers that came to Colorado in the 1800s talked about the sage hen, there wasn't anything talked about in the Crawford area, mainly because of the difficulty of getting there through the Black Canyon and over Black Mesa. But in 1912, William Sclater wrote A History of the Birds of Colorado, where he talked about the presence of grouse in Gunnison County, Mesa County, and Montezuma County. And if you take a triangle between those three counties, the Crawford population is in the middle, so it could be inferred that there were grouse in the Crawford area. The first actual official mention of grouse anywhere close to Crawford was by the assistant director of the Colorado Department of Game and Fish. His name was J.D. Hart, and in 1937, he sent a memo to the director, Parvin, that stated that there was a slight increase in Montrose County, but he didn't say where in Montrose County. Now, for those who aren't familiar with where the Crawford population is, it is north of the Black Canyon, but it is in Montrose County. And he also said that grouse were static in Delta County with a need for slight improvement. In a statewide reconnaissance of sage-grouse by Grover in 1942, he drew a map which showed the top map there. Okay, right there. That's fun. Right there. This is where the Crawford population is, and they didn't show any grouse in that area. In 1942, Woolley interviewed wardens in Colorado about sage-grouse in their district, but again on the map at the bottom, there's a funny arrow, there are no grouse shown in the Crawford area. In 1957, Glenn Rogers, who was employed by the Division of Game, Fish, and Parks, began a study of sage-grouse in Colorado. And he came up with a map that showed showed grouse in that area north of the Black Canyon in Montrose County and also all the way up to Somerset. And he had determined that from every possible source that he could find. And he indicated that sage grouse were found in the Smith Fork Range in the southeast portion of Delta County, near the Dry Fork Creek in the Delta County-Montrose County line, and I have no idea where that is, and then also in the area around Gould Reservoir and near Mare in Montrose County. So there really wasn't much done with the Crawford population for a long time until about 1977, when a BLM field crew went out to the Green Mountain area and found that grouse were on leks. And there's a road that goes out that way, kind of straight from east to west, and the grouse were strutting along that road. That sort of instilled the Division of Wildlife to start beginning counts in 1978, and those counts continued yearly till this date. The problem was is that those grouse were using areas that had been sort of been beat down by livestock at stock ponds, and they were using those beat down areas as their lekking areas. And so to count them, you had to start at the first lek count them, then slowly drive through, the grouse would spread, and then come back, go to the next lek, count that one, and so on, and then come back through the same leks again. From that time, the BLM had started some habitat improvements, but mainly for livestock, and one of the things they did was plow and seed in the early 80s, and the grouse were actually using those plow and seeds to try to strut in. Also at that time, the BLM and the Division of Wildlife were doing aerial searches of leks in winter areas and really didn't find much other than where the leks were already identified. So in 1992, the local HPP committee wanted to do a big game habitat improvement project in that area in Crawford. And this is a pretty good winter area for deer and elk, and so we wanted to try to do improvement for those species in that area. And with concern for the sage-grouse, the local, or the Division of Wildlife grouse expert, who we all know, was invited to come and see if that would be a detriment to the grouse. He came out, looked at what we were going to do, and it was a burn and a little drainage, and he thought that wouldn't be a problem. But that instilled him to hire a temporary in 1994 to do sage-grouse investigations. And by that time, for whatever reason, the grouse had stopped strutting on those leks along the road, and the temporary found out that the grouse were trying to strut around those plow and seeds, and the sagebrush was so tall and thick that they could hardly see each other. Okay.
Better?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, that's all right. So he found out that the grouse were trying to strut in that plow and seed, but the sagebrush had grown up so tall that they were having a hard time seeing each other and having a hard time seeing the hens. The other thing that was going on is around those former areas where the grouse were strutting, they had pinyon juniper around them, and the raptors sitting in that pinyon juniper would watch the grouse trying to strut on the dams of those ponds, and they found a lot of evidence of predation there. So from that, in those investigations by the temporary, the BLM and the Division of Wildlife went in and brush beat those areas that were identified as areas that they were trying to strut, and also removed the pinyon juniper around those leks. In 1996, 12 Crawford area sage grouse were trapped, radio collared, and then tracked for several years. Michelle Commons and Clay Braun then published a paper that they stated that the removal of that pinyon juniper and the brush beating allowed the grouse in the treated areas to increase, and their productivity and their recruitment to increase. And about that time, the Gunnison Basin was doing their forming their working group, and so the BLM and the Division of Wildlife decided that we ought to have a working group in the Crawford area. So the original working group was formed, and they wrote their first working group plan in 1998. It was completed. In 1999, because of the improvements around the leks and the removal of some of the pinyon juniper around those leks, the high male count ended up being 64, which equals about 314 birds in the population. And you can see from that graph that prior to us doing that work, well, you can see in 93 that there was a low count of grouse where they had pretty much abandoned the old leks. So the BLM continued to do habitat improvements in the area, and one of the things that they did was tie into the water line that existed out there that was put in originally by the permittee and created seep areas. That area out there is very xeric. There's not any live water, running water, so the idea was to create seep areas for brood rearing. And the results were mixed. In 1999, the local HPP committee, with BLM consent, built a closure on the C-77 gate, which was the main road going through the Lex. And then that was mainly for big game winter range. And then it was extended to the lecking season several years after that. And then later on, a couple years ago, Montrose County officially closed that road from the 1st of December till the 15th of May. There is continually some habitat improvements and work done on the grouse, but by 2010, we had the lowest count of male grouse on the Lex. And some of the reasons for that, we don't know for sure, but we can suppose that it might have been drought, which is shown from some of the other talks. Maybe it was predation by ravens, which definitely increased in that area. It might have been West Nile virus that might have caused some of that, or it might have been shed hunting in that area. And coincidentally, in 2010, a new working group was formed, a coordinator was hired, and then a new plan was started. And in that plan, a lot of those habitat improvements that we had talked about before were laid out in that plan, and one of them was pinyon juniper removal, because the pinyon juniper was really encroaching on the sagebrush habitat. Also in 2010, a new lek count procedure was initiated, where because of the former count procedure where you had to drive through all the leks, may have been affected some of those lek attendants. One person was assigned to each lek the night before. They stayed out there the night before, then they counted the birds that morning, the next morning, and then when all the birds left all the leks, then everybody left, and so there wasn't any disturbance to the birds. And then finally, the new conservation plan was completed, and it had a lot of those ideas incorporated into that plan. But in January 2011, the National Wild Turkey Federation was awarded $200,000 by the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation for a grant for Gunnison sage-grouse habitat. And the Turkey Federation, they looked at the range-wide plan and decided that they would focus on the Crawford population, because in the range-wide plan it was stated that was the most recoverable population of any of them in the range. And that was enforced by statements by Steve Munson, who toured all the local populations and said that the Crawford population was the most recoverable because of the pinyon juniper removal. So in 2011, in 2012, we began sagebrush restoration on the BLM, funded by both the NIFWIT money and BLM money. And that included hydroaxing, seeding, and slashing, which is basically chainsawing some of the more spread out pinyon juniper. In addition, there was private land removal of pinyon juniper and oak brush that was paid for by the NRCS. And then the local HPP committee had a project on the BLM also, but that was mainly for mule deer habitat, winter range habitat, but it also was it also created sage-grouse habitat. So the total sagebrush restoration by partnership was 5,864 acres. In addition, 8,000 pounds of fresh native forage seed was aerially broadcast over much of the PGA treatment area. And you can see in that slide, you have before the hydrax and after the hydrax. And those juniper trees are kind of spread out here, but there are places where they were really, really tight, but there was sagebrush growing under them. And we didn't really hydrax anything where it didn't have sagebrush under it, because we wanted to have the ability to have that sagebrush to release and increase. In 2011 to 2013, 72 sage grouse from the Gunnison Basin were transplanted to the Crawford area, and they had radio collars on them. And within 2 weeks of some of that sagebrush restoration work, some of these grouse were tracked into that area, and so they were beginning to use it, not only including on the BLM, but also into the private lands. And from 2011 to 2013, we had 13 local sage grouse fitted with GPS PPT collars and were tracked remotely. And this was Doug Oren's project he talked about yesterday. Well, after all that work and habitat improvement and transplanting of grouse, we did have an increase in 2015, which was 31 males on the lek, which equaled a population of 112, and that's based on the 5-year average of 22.8 grouse. And I want to say something about transplanting grouse to the Crawford area. If we'd have waited until the grouse were extirpated from the Crawford area and transplanted one, you know, grouse from the Gunnison Basin, there wouldn't have been the local knowledge of the local grouse teaching the transplanted grouse where to go, where the leks were, and anything. They'd have to find it out on their own. So we felt that it was important to transplant those grouse before the Crawford population blinked out. So recent and continuing improvements, in 2014, the BLM hydroxed another 200 acres south of Gould Reservoir. And last fall, we, a youth group, with the help of some people in the working group in the BLM, constructed 85 Z-dikes that were the areas were actually mapped out by Bill. What did I do, spell it wrong? That's, I do that all the time, sorry. So the continuing improvements for this year are going to rebrush beat the overgrown leks, because the sagebrush has grown into some of those leks, and we think that maybe we're not seeing all the grouse on those leks because of the sagebrush that's hiding them. More Z dikes will be constructed, and then we're also going to do some more PJ hydroaxing and or slashing between the active leks, because we have leks on the east side of the habitat and leks on the west side of the habitat. Nothing in the middle, but we have pinyon juniper growing up in there. So the agencies and organizations that have been credited, there's a lot of people involved in that, and they have either worked for or been belong to one or more of those agencies that are listed there. Does anybody have questions?
You mentioned shed hunting as a possible cause for decline. You want to? Is there any more insights on that, or where's that coming
from? Well, let me explain. The Crawford area, as compared to the Gunnison area, is much smaller. And correct me if I'm wrong, Missy, but it's about 35,000 acres. And that's pretty small, but it gets a big concentration of deer and elk in the wintertime. It's a major winter area. And there is a tremendous influx of shed hunters into that area. Now, the gate's closed, but they can still walk into that area and collect shed antlers. And we think what they're doing is those shed hunters are gridding the area, going up and down, back and forth, looking for those sheds. They're not just walking out to C-77 room. They're gridding back and forth. And they're doing this when the snow leaves, and about that time is when the hens are starting to go in the nest, or the males are strutting on the leks. And we feel there may be a disturbance factor there. We haven't documented that, and we're not sure how we can do that documentation. This is all anecdotal, but we think that there may be some effect on that. And one of the things, I used to open the gate for that when that gate was open. The dates changed. It was August 15th, and it was May 1st, and it's May 15th. I opened that, used to open that gate, and it was like the Oklahoma land rush, with people going out there on four-wheelers, four-wheel drives, horseback, and I mean, it was unbelievable how they go out there. And it was just for a day or two, but man, they were out there like crazy. And when we're out doing our leg counts, we're seeing people out there all the time walking out there or out there on horseback looking for antlers. So that's what we think maybe, we think that might be a factor in some of that decline.
Awesome. Thank you, Doug.
Okay.